I've come to China to try and make sense of what to many of us in the West seems like an alien planet. The People's Republic is poised to become the largest economy in the world. And that affects all of us. As Western banks and governments ask China to bail them out, we face the prospect of the Chinese one day becoming our new masters.
You must be Mr. Yin. Ni hao.
As the West once dominated China. The trouble is, we know so little about the Chinese. One of the questions I want to answer is how the most populous nation on the planet, a fifth of humanity, manages to live under a communist system of government, yet appears to have the world's most dynamic capitalist economy. I think I can solve the mystery by peering into one of the darkest periods of Chinese history. The time of Mao Zedong, the man who turned China red. Today, Mao shrines are absolutely packed with besotted pilgrims.
What does Chairman Mao mean to you today?
But wasn't Mao the communist hardliner who imprisoned businessmen and executed capitalist running dogs? Didn't he inflict more chaos on China than anybody before or since? So is Mao worship mass delusion? Or was Mao really the man who built modern China? Sometimes I find it hard to relate the sophisticated, supercharged, even swaggering place that is China today with the drab, bicycle-propelled China of Mao Zedong. Yet it seems that most Chinese don't have a problem making the connection. In this Beijing restaurant called the Red Classic, a crowd of happy diners are enjoying a Cultural Revolution meal. Waitresses in Green Army uniforms and red serve the people armbands greet you with the words, "I swear to Chairman Mao that I will serve you with all my heart."
I've never seen anything crazier than that in my life. I mean, it's just surreal. It's as if you walked into a German restaurant and saw everybody standing on the chairs singing the Horst Wessel song and waving swastikas. Or as if you went into a restaurant in Moscow and everybody was dressed up as Stalin or Gulag guards. But the fact of the matter is, Mao killed more of his own people than either Hitler or Stalin. And yet, here in China, he's wildly popular. And if you don't believe me, just take a look at this madness.
You might call it Maostalgia, a harking back to old days that were, in reality, anything but good. This is a reenactment of one of the civil war battles that tore China apart from the late 1920s to the late 1940s, between Chiang Kai-shek's nationalists and Mao's communists. In this battle, the nationalists launch a counterattack against the Red Army in Yan'an.
Watching this reenactment, you'd be forgiven for thinking it was the communists who won this battle. But in fact, they lost it and were driven from Yunnan by the nationalist forces. It was only 2 years later, in 1949, that the communists got the upper hand and drove the nationalists off mainland China to the island of Taiwan.
What I'm discovering is that when it comes to the history of China, there's what really happened, and then there's the official airbrush version for public consumption. In the case of Mao, there's a huge difference between the man and the myth. The myth started here in Yan'an. It's where the Communist Party and the Red Army was based for 12 years while Mao consolidated his power. So it's hardly surprising that he's popular here. Hu Muying lived in Yan'an as a child in one of these cave houses, right next to Mao's. A nicer man you couldn't hope to meet.
What do you recollect of Chairman Mao? How do you remember him?
Not so surprising, perhaps, to hear that Mao was kind to children, but it's what she says next that I find so telling. In this film, I'll meet a lot of people like Mrs. Hu, who revere Mao as the father of modern China. But no one ever seems to engage with the fundamental contradiction that a hardline communist is regarded as the father of the capitalist China I see all around me. Even while patting children on the head at Yan'an, Mao was already showing his ruthless streak, purging 10,000 Communist Party members to secure his grip on the party.
This was the man who, on the 1st of October 1949, stood right here in Tiananmen Square and proclaimed a new People's Republic of China.
The problems facing Mao were immense. There had been over 100 years of turmoil, what the Chinese call Dong Luan, in which tens of millions had died. The old imperial government had collapsed, only to be replaced by a weak republic torn apart by civil war and foreign occupation. By 1949, there was practically no working system of government. China's 550 million people had been reduced to the verge of starvation. The country was in a state of exhausted chaos, on the verge of falling apart.
Mao had to act swiftly. He had to do something to hold China together and also to make sure that it never again fell apart into chaos. So he set about creating a system of government so pervasive that it could reach into every nook and cranny of people's lives. And he set about doing it with something that was characteristically drastic and violent.
You're never going to understand the nature of Mao's rule if you confine yourself to China's cities. When he took power, after all, his support base was the illiterate peasantry. They were the overwhelming majority of the population. Their standard of living in 1949 was wretchedly low, perhaps lower than at any time for 2,000 years. Mao set out to transform their lives. No matter how much I read about China, I never really get used to the mind-boggling numbers. In the 1950s, Mao began by expropriating more than 200 million acres from the landowning class. At the same time, The landlords were publicly disgraced. Then, more than 700,000 of them were executed. This bloodbath heralded a radical transformation of Chinese society. For in the vacuum of power resulting from the elimination of the landowning class, Mao installed his own ruling class, creating a system of social control that went beyond anything previously seen in China's history.
Now the Communist Party could reach down into every nook and cranny of Chinese society. The party decided where you lived, it decided what you wore, it decided what you ate, what you read, what you thought. In every apartment building like this, there was a party member just keeping an eye on things. There still is.
Here in the little village of Chongkan in Anhui province, Yao Gong is a sent-down cadre, literally sent down to the country to enforce Central Communist Party policy and keep his ear to the ground. The fact that almost every village in China today has someone like Mr. Yao is down to Mao. Before Mao, Imperial China was ruled over by some 20,000 civil servants. By 1957, the Communist Party had signed up 12 million new activists in towns and villages across the country. The party's takeover was complete. What Mao had done was to create a political system so powerful that it could unleash a force capable of transforming China. The mass mobilization of the Chinese people themselves. But when Mao did mobilize the people in what was supposed to be a great leap forward, the result was catastrophic.
Oh, Peggy!
At NatWest, we've been helping families save for generations. Remember these? Whether it's your kid's university or a rainy day, hasn't got any easier.
Which you are not in Kansas anymore. You are on Pandora.
The network premiere of James Cameron's Avatar, Sunday at 5:50 on 4.
Up there beyond that fence, every living thing wants to kill you.
Welcome to your new body, Jake.
This is great.
You have a strong heart. No fear.
Haven't gotten lost in the woods, have you?
The Sky people have sent us a message.
Let's get this done.
We will send them a message.
That this is our land!
How's it feel to betray your own race?
Avatar, Sunday at 5:50 on 4.
Welcome to Changsha. This is Mao country. In other parts of the world, you get the Pope here, or Jesus Christ, or David Beckham. But in Changsha, you get Chairman Mao.
Changsha is another of China's cities that is hurtling into the future at warp speed. Yet in a dramatic counterpoint to China's new identity as a modern capitalist economy, you have this. The biggest statue of Mao in the world.
There he is, the young Mao, 105 feet high and sporting a rather odd Beethoven hairdo. The amazing thing is that despite his murderous policies, Mao remains hugely popular here in China. Indeed, in Changsha, where he studied as a young man, you won't hear a word against him. This is quite a ritual. People come from all over China in groups to lay a wreath at the statue of Chairman Mao. What you're seeing now is the group photo. That goes in the mantelpiece back home.
Just look at these tourists with their digital cameras, Gucci bags, and their Nikes. Why on earth should they be grateful to Mao? What did he do to give them the lifestyle they enjoy today? It certainly isn't obvious. Because in 1958, Mao launched the Great Leap Forward, one of the most horrific man-made disasters in world history. To understand its impact, I travel to its front line, to the Chinese countryside.
In many ways, the little village of Shaogang in Anhui is a microcosm of all that happened in China between 1949 and 1989. Every single revolution seemed to hit this village in the solar plexus.
Were you one of the... Mr. Yan's family have been peasant farmers in Shaogang for generations. In the beginning, they'd been happy to see Mao's purge of the landowning class and to be given their own land. But then, just 5 years later, Mao turned his policy upside down. By the mid-1950s, party representatives were ordered to herd Mr. Yan's family and millions like them off their newly acquired land and into state-run collective farms. From 1958, all land in China was to be communally owned. The extraordinary thing about the Great Leap Forward was the sheer scale and speed of it. Such was the control of Mao's political machine that by the end of 1958, 700 million people, 99% of the peasant population, were living in 26,000 communes. Then, to meet Mao's industrial growth targets, the communes were ordered to hand in millions of tons of household pots and pans and farming machinery, and to melt them down in makeshift iron foundries. As a result, grain production fell every single year between 1958 and 1962. But the government continued to collect its quotas for city dwellers as if output was rising. The result was a calamitous famine.
Did many people starve? Did people die in your village?
That represented roughly half the village's population. The Communist Party has done its level best to cover up what Mao really did. But just occasionally, their monopoly on historical knowledge is breached. Thanks to some creative research, I managed to get hold of an internal party assessment of the Great Leap Forward, a document that remained secret for more than 20 years.
This is a 596-page report on the impact of Mao's policy on just one rural area, Fengyang County here in Anhui Province. Commissioned in 1987 by the Chinese Communist Party, it contains an absolutely damning indictment of the impact of the Great Leap Forward on the Chinese countryside.
Fengyang County around Shaogang was one of the worst affected areas.
In Fuhuang village in Damiao commune, the death toll in 1959 and 1960 was as high as 68.6%. There were 63 cases of cannibalism across the county. Here, Chen Jiangying and her husband Zhao Xizhen killed and boiled their 8-year-old son and ate him.
The catastrophe of the Great Leap Forward remains taboo in China. And as I look at the figures, I can see why. In just 4 years between 1958 and 1961, at least 35 million people, nearly all of them peasants, died of famine or famine-related diseases. Some say it was 45 million. That's equivalent to the entire population of Canada or Spain today. This wasn't a great leap forward. It was more like a gargantuan fall backward. In any normal society, a politician responsible for such a catastrophe would be reviled. Yet the Chinese still seem to adore Mao.
It is really hard to fathom. People, some of whose ancestors must have died at his hands, literally worshipping Chairman Mao. I think part of what's happened here is that a very large airbrush has been applied to the Mao years of China's history. Well, here I am in the newly refurbished National Museum in Beijing, enjoying the very impressive exhibit about the early years of the People's Republic. This is section 2, setting up the basic socialist system. So somewhere around here, there ought to be a pretty impressive exhibit about the Great Leap Forward. I can't seem to find it. Excuse me. I've been trying to find the exhibit on the Great Leap Forward, but I can't find it anywhere. Can you tell me where it is?
She's not really sure. You better go to the information desk and ask.
Okay, well, thank you very much. We'll go and take a look. Incredibly, that seems to be it. One picture of primitive iron smelting with a mildly critical commentary and absolutely no mention of the millions who died.
It only makes sense when you realize that this is an official history, rubber stamped by the Communist Party. Even though the men in business suits who run China today have embraced market forces in a way that Mao never would have, they still owe their position to the party that he built. And the truth about Mao's excesses can't be allowed to undermine that party's authority. Instead, the cult of Mao survives. Indeed, it seems to thrive. It seems even more extraordinary when you consider what Mao did next. The Great Leap Forward was such a disaster that Mao's authority began to be questioned. His leadership came under attack from within the party itself. Another leader might have concluded from all this that he'd been mistaken. Not Mao. His conclusion was that it was the party he'd built that was at fault. By 1966, he saw the only solution as yet another revolution. This time, a cultural revolution. At its heart would be the personality cult of the great helmsman himself.
A nation of shopaholics.
I've spent £100,000.
We help some of these hoarders to confront their habits.
How did all that fit in our apartment?
Sell their belongings and transform their lives and homes.
I really believe great interiors shape the way that people behave.
Get your house in order Thursday at 8 on 4.
It's so easy to get swept away by the tide of modernity engulfing China that it's tempting to dismiss those devoted to keeping Mao's memory alive as misty-eyed relics wallowing in nostalgia. But to my mind, they symbolise something that goes right to the heart of Mao's legacy. The importance of the Communist Party he built to the making of modern China.
Ni hao. Hello, ni hao. Mr. Lu.
Hey, ni hao.
Ni hao. Very nice indeed to meet you. Thank you for letting me come to your house.
Thank you, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
May I come in?
请进。
There's the great helmsman right in the front door. Fantastic.
This is 1957. 毛主席, this is me.
Yeah, there you are.
This is my wife.
Who's that? Ah, of course. Fantastic. What a wonderful picture. Well,
let's.
Can we look at some of the pictures in your book?
I've come to meet Lu Homin, who was Mao Zedong's personal photographer for more than 20 years. He has an extraordinary archive.
Do you have a favourite photograph, one of Chairman Mao, that you think really captures his personality? Yeah. Was he relaxed and easygoing? Was it easy to photograph him, or was he difficult to deal with? It's that familiar refrain, the one I hear everywhere I go. Mao as Mr. Nice Guy. Mao as the father of the new China. Yet this was a father who was capable of inflicting one unnatural disaster after another on his own children. The Cultural Revolution began innocuously enough with a rather surreal photo opportunity.
On July 16th, 1966, Mao swam the Yangtze in a calculated display of youthful vigour. No mean feat for a man of 73. 2 weeks later, he wrote a letter to agitators at the Tsinghua University Middle School, expressing his passionate support for their efforts and dubbing them the Red Guards. This was the cue for young people all over China to form Red Guards, pledging their undying loyalty to Chairman Mao.
I more or less get what the Great Leap Forward was meant to achieve, misjudged and murderous though it turned out to be. But the Cultural Revolution just looks like madness. Millions of young people flocking to a succession of vast rallies in Tiananmen Square, dressed in identikit uniforms and brandishing the little red book of Mao's pithiest words of wisdom. What exactly was Mao trying to achieve by unleashing what seems like a wave of teenage hysteria? His stated ambition was to remove the capitalist elements that were still impeding China's progress. But he also intended to implement a ruthless purge of his critics. In the first program of this series, we met this man, Qin Shi Huang, the first emperor of China. On being compared to Qin, Mao retorted, "He buried 460 scholars alive. We have buried 46,000. We have surpassed Qin Shi Huang 100-fold.
Chairman Mao is here. Chairman Mao is here."
Mao was indeed the natural heir of a 2,000-year tradition of autocracy, if not tyranny. The rule of one man. Yet there was more to the Cultural Revolution than just the assertion of Mao's power as the Red Emperor. To understand its real significance, I've come to Chongqing, This megacity is one of the marvels of today's economic miracle in China. On the surface, it seems the antithesis of Mao's hardline communism. But back in 1967, it felt the full bloody force of the Cultural Revolution. In a country where great pains are taken to remove traces of this violent period, this gloomy place is all the more haunting.
Here in this dingy corner of Chongqing's Shopping Bar Park, there's a real rarity. It's a cemetery for victims of the Cultural Revolution.
Buried here within its walls are the bodies of 537 Red Guards from different factions who, after dealing with their teachers, then turned on each other as they competed to be the purest of Mao's followers. The tombstones have inscriptions like, "I can give my head and blood, but can never give up Mao Zedong fort."
Ni hao, ni hao. You must be a professor here. And you must be Mr. Han. Very good to meet you, very good to meet you. Let's go and walk up here together. Professor, did Mao intend to create such anarchy? Or was it an accident that the Cultural Revolution produced so much violence? Did you know any of the people who are buried in there?
我认识.
Yes.
Some of your friends?
Yes.
I hate to ask this question, but did you kill anyone in another Red Guard faction?
这个我因为这样的这个我直接的那种开枪打死某一个人这种情况没有为什么呢就离得比较远你开枪也不知道他死没有这倒是一个情况但相反的话就是互相之间那个用刀这种有就他躲我也躲他这种杀他也有这种
Incredibly, just 200 yards away from the graves of Cultural Revolution victims are women who clearly lived through that time of violence, singing songs that glorify the period. Hits like "Chairman Mao is the sun that never sets." It's part of a Mao revival orchestrated by the Chongqing Communist Party secretary, Bo Xilai.
Can I ask why you're singing these songs? But these songs are from the Cultural Revolution. I thought that was a bad time. And that's the point. As the lady said, it's the Communist Party, the party that Mao built, that looks after her today. Maostalgia isn't just old ladies singing songs or photographers fondly remembering the old days, or pilgrims like these bowing down at Mao shrines. It's about acknowledging Mao's role in building the Communist Party into an all-powerful social and political force. The official line is that Mao's time in China was 70% good and 30% bad. As far as I can see, most people here accept that. Maybe they even think the 30% bad is a bit on the high side.
Mao was certainly the perpetrator of some of history's most disastrous policies. But surely his popularity wouldn't be so high if there was absolutely no upside to his rule. Even amid the horrors of the Great Leap Forward, there were some remarkable achievements. When Mao died in 1976, per capita income was nearly double what it had been when he came to power. Life expectancy increased by 25 years. Crucially, what Mao had done was to put a system in place, a massive party machine that could do great harm, but also had the capacity to transform China for the better, if it was in the right hands. After Mao's death in 1976, those hands would be Deng Xiaoping's. When I see Deng's face looming over the modern China he built, or watch the pilgrims lining up at his Mao-style shrine, I find it easy to forget that he too was once an enemy of the state. In the Cultural Revolution, Mao branded Deng a capitalist roader and sent him to work in a tractor factory. His son was tortured by Red Guards. But after the disasters of the Great Leap Forward and the Cultural Revolution, Deng had been reinstated as an economic reformer. And by 1978, he was China's leader. With Mao gone, a new and very different revolution was about to begin. Remember the village of Shaogang, which suffered so much during the Great Leap Forward, losing half its population to starvation?
In the carefully crafted history of the Chinese Communist Party, few events require more delicate handling than the one that happened here in the sleepy little village of Shaogang in 1978. It was in this cramped and dingy little shack that 18 farmers secretly met, pricked their thumbs, and used the blood to sign this pledge. And in it, they agreed to reverse 20 years of forcible and failed collectivization. What they decided was that they would take the communally owned land of the village and divide it up for individual use. In effect, this was a highly risky do-it-yourself privatization.
It turns out that Shaogang farmer Mr. Yen, who'd survived the murderous years of the Great Leap Forward and kept his head down during the Cultural Revolution, was the true revolutionary.
Mr. Yen, were you one of the 18 farmers who signed the pledge, who signed that document?
There.
Can you tell me why they did that?
当时呢，我们呢，主要是在我们小岗那个年代呢，就是由于过去那种吃大锅饭呀，那个年代呀，把这个人心困散了。最后呢，那就是体现出来呢，就是分配上的不合理，就是人心呢，就是凝聚不到一堆，没有积极性。最后呢，在这种情况下，我们找对了适合我们中国农民走的路子。
If you think about what Mr. Yen and the other farmers did, it really is rather humbling. Such was their determination to lead a better life that he and his fellow signatories took on no less than the might of the Chinese Communist Party.
Under Mao, what these farmers had done would have risked a death sentence. But it was completely different under Deng Xiaoping. As this monument makes clear, he gave the farmers his blessing. As he'd famously said years before, it doesn't matter if the cat is black or white, as long as it catches the mouse.
Deng realized he could take the party machine that Mao had built and combine it with private enterprise and the profit motive. Mass mobilization plus individual capitalism. This unique hybrid would be the basis for a new revolution. The revolution that made China what it is today.
The new Vauxhall Zafira Tourer. 7 adjustable flex seats. 2 spacious lounge chairs. 1 vast panoramic windscreen. Space for almost anything. The new Vauxhall Zafira Tourer. The future of space travel.
Why would you visit Ireland just to gaze at our countryside? Just to admire our pubs? Or stroll through our fair cities, for that matter? Why would you do any of that when you can jump in? Let the place take hold of you. Come on, don't be shy. Jump into Ireland. Visit discoverireland.com. And right now you can jump onto an Aer Lingus.com flight to Dublin from just $24.99 one way.
More people save tax-free with Halifax than any other bank. So we had an idea. We'll give even more people the chance to celebrate. In our Savers Prize Draw this May, we've over £1 million in prizes, with 10 savers each winning £100,000. Save tax-free with Halifax, and don't miss your chance to win. Halifax, the people who give you extra.
Sport ou extrême, Chanel.
Vauxhall Zafira Tourer with 0% APR representative, no minimum deposit, and you choose the payment term.
This is a dream for a dealer.
Ordinary objects with extraordinary stories. Find out how much they're really worth Wednesday at 8.
Do you have a sensible price?
The dealers competing for a bargain.
It's a perfect object.
The sellers looking to hold their nerve.
We're getting close.
And make a fortune.
We bought in a car once owned by Kate Middleton.
Everything has a price.
Harry Potter memorabilia.
I want it.
How far north of 10,000 do I have to go?
What, you won't take 50?
Think about it before you leave because you can't come back.
50,000 quid?
That's a high figure.
And on top of it, I will give you a kiss, no tongue. Ah!
4 top dealers do battle when 4 Rooms returns. Wednesday at 8 on 4.
By the early 1980s, Deng Xiaoping's revolution had set the Chinese economy on fire. Special economic zones offered foreign investors unbeatable deals. Low taxes, free trade, and the cheapest labor in the world. As a result of Deng's policies, growth exploded, and more than 300 million people gave up being peasant farmers to become factory workers. A mass mobilization that was Maoist in its scale, though not its intent. At the same time, the pent-up potential of millions of would-be entrepreneurs was unleashed as town and village enterprises were legalized. The car and motorcycle manufacturer Li Fan Motors was set up in 1992 by Yin Ming Shan, with $25,000 of capital and just 9 employees.
You must be Mr. Yin. Ni hao. Very nice indeed to meet you. Thank you so much for giving us your time today. I know.
Thank you for your coming.
I know how busy you must be.
Last year, Mr. Yin sold 1.5 million motorcycles. He employs 15,000 people and exports his bikes and cars to 150 countries around the world. It's an extraordinary success story. But then, Mr. Yin has an extraordinary history. So long as Mao ruled China, someone with his capitalist tendencies was an enemy of the state.
Let's walk a little further down here where it's quieter. To be a capitalist in the 1960s was almost to be a criminal. Can he tell me what his experience was? Was he actually imprisoned for his beliefs?
I think the reason is that 确实会把你抓起来坐牢，我本人确实坐不了。How many years
was he in jail?
那他想问你，你见到惨痛的经历有多少年时间？我坐牢只坐了9个半月，但是整整21年，是打成最低的一种贱民，还不起头，随时都叫你来批斗，20年，现在被关起了20年。
In those 21 years, what did you do? You couldn't do business. So what did you actually do to live?
And yet that new future very nearly evaporated when demands began to grow for political as well as economic reforms. That's why what happened in Tiananmen Square in June 1989 was so important.
70 years before, in May 1919, students had marched here in Tiananmen and had unfurled banners like this one, which reads Mr. De and Mr. Zhe, short for Mr. Democracy and Mr. Science, two Western characters the students felt that China should get to know better. In the summer of 1989, this same poster was unfurled once again.
The square was filled with nearly 1 million Chinese workers and students demanding a greater say in their country's government. But Deng was convinced that his dream of an economically prosperous China would be shattered if the Communist Party's monopoly on power were to be challenged. He overruled the proponents of compromise. On the night of the 3rd of June 1989, at his command, the tanks rolled in. We still don't know for sure how many protesters were killed. Probably hundreds, maybe more. Hundreds more were arrested, imprisoned, or forced into exile. But the message was clear. Mao's system of control was as strong as ever. The events of 1989 remain so sensitive today that almost no one wants to talk about them. The airbrush strikes again. The results of Deng's economic revolution have been spectacular, propelling the Chinese economy from nowhere to being the second largest in the world. But the key thing to grasp is the indispensable role played in the process by Mao's system of mass mobilization and party control.
Take a look at the skyline of Chongqing today, if you can make it out through the smog.
This just would not be possible in the West. Think of the planning inquiries. You'd never get past the drawing board stage. These poker-faced party functionaries may be the living antithesis of Mao's personality cult, but they couldn't do their job without the power machine that he built. Even multimillionaires like Mr. Yin can prosper only if they make a deal with the one-party state.
Make no mistake, the system these guys live under is a communist state still, with all the deeply entrenched traditions of bureaucratic and authoritarian rule. Question is, does it need to be? Is it true to claim, as China's leaders do, that their party and only their party is what stands between these people and Dongluan, chaos? Or is that a completely implausible claim from an organization that itself has inflicted so much chaos on China in the past?
Will this hybrid communist-capitalist model continue to work? Or as China's per capita income continues to rise and a huge new middle class emerges, will trying to maintain a one-party system be a recipe for renewed upheaval?
In the final film in this series, I'll be asking what next for China as it approaches the astonishing milestone of becoming the biggest economy in the world. Can it aspire to rule the world? Or will just ruling itself be a big enough challenge?
To my mind, the future for all of us hangs on the answer to those questions.
Embarrassing Bodies is next on 4 with troublesome hands, teeth, tonsils and big bother below the belt. Then a soul food restaurant with a wok, a pizza oven, a mouse and an owner who won't listen to anyone. New Kitchen Nightmares USA at 10.